Hello and welcome to NewsClick. Today we have with us D. Raghunandan, who's been following up the issue of defense policies and WikiLeaks. Raghu, lot of the arguments that came from the left, which was originally thought to be a part of the left's conspiracy theory, seems to have been borne out by the WikiLeaks.
Yes. In fact, the WikiLeaks revelations of the cable so far as the Indo-US defense agreement and other related things are concerned, to me the most surprising part of it is that there are so few surprises. Most of what we read are stuff that was known and that the left and others were pointing out at that time anyway. In particular, on the Indo-US defense agreement, what seems clear from the cables is that the US was particularly keen on pushing through the defense agreement because they saw this as the major way in which to bring India into the US geostrategic orbit. And that to me is one of the clearest signals coming out from the cables that we've seen from WikiLeaks so far.
You think that the geostrategic vision of getting incorporating India into a kind of ring around China, do you think that is the central reason for this? Or do you think also it goes hand in hand with the commercial interests selling a large number of military hardware to India?
Of course, the commercial interests were uppermost in the minds of the US embassy personnel here in Delhi, because that's what they would have been working to push. And it also must have been very high up on the agenda. But the cables also show that the military sales were seen as not just as an end in themselves, but as a means to cement a closer military-to-military relationship between the US and India, and a closer foreign policy and geostrategic relationship of India with the US. The China angle doesn't seem to have figured so heavily, at least in the cables that we have seen so far, which is not to say that it didn't exist, or not even to say that they were not there in the cables. These are the cables that we have seen, which are India specific. But there is sufficient evidence to show that the US was looking at India as a very important cog in a geostrategic wheel in this region, transcending South Asia and Southeast Asia. And I think that was the importance to them.
As far as the military response was concerned, it was a little surprising that a lot of people in the military felt very uncomfortable with the kind of conditions that US was putting onto military sales, which virtually meant that the US would still control the hardware it would sell. Do you think that this is in spite of the pressure that came from the Indian government, upper echelons, to press Indian military as well as other officials for the deals?
Absolutely, I think so. In two ways. One is linking to the previous question that you asked. The commercial interests were, of course, important to the US. The US talks of the huge Indian defense market, which they have put at something like $27 to $30 billion in the near term. They are still looking, according to the cables, for breakthrough sales, which from the US point of view still hasn't come, which to the US would be the medium multi-role combat aircraft deal, the so-called mother of all deals, which is likely to come. That would be the thing. But despite that, there's been very large military sales from India to the US. I think from the US to India. But I think from the Indian military's point of view, there are two areas of concern. One is the military, to some extent, welcomed these as a diversification of the Indian purchase pool away from the former Soviet Union alone, but at the same time was conscious of the fact that any weaponry which is acquired, which is of critical weight to the Indian military, but which is likely to see a Indo-Pakistan conflict, the military is extremely wary of, because in the eventuality of a conflict, the Americans could easily block supplies. One shouldn't forget that for the military, weaponry is their bread and butter. And playing around with that means that the fundamental military ability can get quite badly upset. So we see, I think, a two-track approach by the Indian military, selectively purchasing some weaponry, but being very cautious of critical weaponry which may put pressure on them at times of conflict.
You know, it's interesting to look at the range of people in the Indian establishment who seems to be in contact with the embassy, starting from very lower levels of officials to the highest in the country, virtually the ministers, the foreign secretaries and so on. It's also interesting that the promotions seem to have also been linked with the kind of policies they were actually pushing. In fact, the case in the example, if Shiv Shankar Menon jumped over a whole lot of people, including Rajiv Sikri, and Rajiv Sikri is mentioned as a person who has NAM pretensions, who actually is a part of the old Nehruvian lobby, and very harsh things were said about him when he visited Israel and the settlements and looked at the Palestine issue. Do you think that is also a bit of a surprise that the amount of influence that the US embassy seems to have been wielding at different levels in the Indian establishment?
To me, that was the one area which the cables brought out, which perhaps was not as well known or well appreciated in India, is the extent to which the Americans put pressure to influence policy, and perhaps even more interesting from the Indian point of view, the extent to which the top Indian political leadership not only succumbed to these pressures, but perhaps welcomed it as well. There's clear evidence from the cables that the Americans were disquieted at and surprised at the resistance that they were getting from the civilian bureaucracy, as well as from sections of the military bureaucracy, to their advances. They thought there would be a jump at this offer, and they have specifically said that it is the economists in the Indian government which are going to be our major allies. And we all know that the leading economists are, of course, the heads of our government and those who are guiding the economic and political development in this.
Basically, the Prime Minister Manmohan Singh, P. Chidambaram, and of course, Montek Singh Ahluwalia. These are the three known people who have been formulating a set of policies and have also been pushing this for a time.
Whereas the foreign policy establishment, a large part of the military leadership, is not just NAM centered, but also has a conception of an Indian independent position, not tied to the apron strings of the United States, which, apart from any ideological considerations, is not seen as being something which would advance sovereign Indian interests, which after all has been part of the training of these establishments for a long time.
If you look at it, India, in diversifying its arms basket, has gone to Israel, virtually a substitute for the United States in that sense, and now is also looking to the United States for a number of critical sales. What do you think the Indian long-term view on defense purchases should be, and how should we build in that sense? If we wanted the military hardware, what should be the policy with regard to military hardware?
It's a very interesting question. I don't know whether we can deal with it effectively in the time we have. The Indian interest in diversifying towards Israel is partly because of the weakness of the Soviet system in the avionics sector, which compelled us to look at Western suppliers, and Israel was the easiest to approach and was cheaper compared to the French alternatives, apart from the, as you said, the route that it gave us to the Americans.
In fact, it has been argued that India was being close to Israel in order to also cement its relationship with the United States.
And in fact, we would not have been able to procure these items from Israel unless it had the blessings of Big Brother at the back. But I think it's also significant that in trying to diversify our military purchases, etc., this tussle that we have with the United States in terms of the US wanting India to sign a variety of agreements, logistics agreements, communication support agreements, all these come with strings attached. And the more strings that are attached to each of these agreements, the more resistance they seem to encounter from within the Indian military establishment as well as from other sections of the Indian administration. But the other thing that is happening now is under pressure, not only in terms of going into the Western market, but seeing an erosion of Indian manufacturing capability, the Indian government is opening up the Indian private sector to undertake defense manufacturing, which is of course a major departure from the earlier practice of Indian defense manufacture being essentially a state sector area. This is also interestingly being done under pressure from the United States and its Western allies, because India has a so-called offsets policy, but the offsets will mean transfer of technology. And none of the Western companies want to transfer technology unless they have a majority stake in these industries. Therefore, opening up the Indian private sector, which is put forward as a way of building indigenous defense capability, is in fact going to be a backdoor opening of foreign investment by foreign armaments manufacturers into the private Indian defense industry, and then controlling this, by which case they would have a stranglehold on even domestic Indian manufacture.
And therefore by proxy, of the entire military
exactly.
hardware that India would then have. Interesting enough, while we are encouraging Indian private sector to enter manufacturing, the manufacturing is being entered quite often in collusion, in partnership with Israeli state-owned companies. In that, it's an interesting issue that here you ask the private sector to go into a partnership with the Israeli state sector, and Israel is a much smaller country than India. So therefore, if it can build its own state sector armaments industries, why Indian Indian industry cannot do so? Public sector cannot do so is difficult to understand. Thanks, Raghu. This has been an interesting discussion, and I think we have to see which way the mother of all deals, the aircraft deal, 126 aircraft, which India is in the market to buy. Thanks.